Hey everyone, in this video we're going to do a code walkthrough of the cookie clicker app, and then when we're all done we're going to take that file and put it up on flipc.org so that for future people who want to use it, it's as simple as just finding the application, clicking on it, they'll see a banner and some screenshots, and they can pick which firmware they want and just install onto their flipper. So thanks to Talking Sasquatch for showing this flipc.org site last week, and thanks to TechInFund for suggesting a code walkthrough. If you're not interested in code, jump to 11 minutes and 4 seconds. All right, let's get started. Okay, this is part of Flipper Zero Tutorials, HID, HID cookie. So if you want to follow along, you can go there on GitHub. I'm going to skip down to the local setup section. If you haven't already watched my YouTube video from last week, it talks about how to set up Visual Studio Code and how to clone both the firmware repository and the tutorial repository. So I'm going to assume that you've done these steps already. If not, go ahead and take a look at that video. So once everything is cloned, we're going to right click on Application Users, click on Open an Integrated Terminal. We're going to copy this command over. So new item, dash path, hid cookie, item type junction, value, the hid cookie. Go ahead and press enter. Now we have a hid cookie folder. Open hid.c, and then we're going to do Control Shift B again. That will open our build task list. Choose build update bundle. We'll do Control Shift B again. Wait for that message. It says terminal's done. And then launch app on Flipper. Once that completes, I'll open the QFlipper app. We'll go into instructions and scroll down to see all the instructions. Then we'll look at the credits and scroll down to those. Then we'll go into the main app. Press down to slow down the speed. Press up to speed it up. Press OK to start clicking. It's clicking, turn it off. And then we'll use the back button to exit the app. So now let's take a look at the code. We'll start with the application.fam file. So this file defines metadata about our application, the application ID, the name of our application, the entry point's the name of the method in our C file, the category is which folder it'll appear in underneath applications, the icon defines our application's icon, the icon assets sets the folder where all the images for our application are. This is just the icon for our app. These are our registered views. We have the submenu when the app launches, and then the views for the instructions, clicker, and the credits. So this hid structure came from the original code. In other programs, you'll see the more generic word app. So we have an object for Bluetooth, GUI, notification app, and view dispatcher. These came from the original app. And then we have a submenu, widget instruction, widget credit, cookie clicker hid, and the view ID that we're on. We also define some mouse methods that'll be used by our views. So we made our tag as cookie clicker app, that's used for logging. Our submenu, we have instructions, the clicker, and the credits. Our submenu callback gets invoked with an index, and we look up based on that index, we decide which view ID to set, and then we call view dispatcher switch to view with that view ID. Instead of these ifs, we'd probably be better to use a switch statement, and then pull that view outside of the switch. In change callback, if our status is connected, we set the light to blue, otherwise we reset it. We then use hid cc set connected status, passing it our connected status, so the UI shows the Bluetooth indicator filled in or not. Hid submenu view and hid exit just return our views back. In hid alloc, we're allocating our hid, and then we're setting our GUI, our Bluetooth, our notifications, and our view dispatcher. Then we attach the view dispatcher to the GUI with full screen. Next, we allocate our submenu, set its header to cookie clicker. We add the three items, instructions, Bluetooth phone, and credits. We set the back button, previous callback, to go to hid exit. And then we add the view to the dispatcher and tell the view dispatcher to switch to the view, which will show our submenu. In hid app alloc view, we do our widget alloc, and then we add a text scroll element with the instructions. We set the back button to go to the submenu, And then we add this view to our view dispatcher. We call cookie clicker alloc. We set its back button to our submenu, and we add its view to the view dispatcher. Then we allocate a widget for our credits. We add a text scroll element with the credits. We set the back button to go to our submenu view, and we add that view to our view dispatcher. Hid free just releases all our resources. The next four methods are mouse helper methods that'll be used by our views. They just invoke the FRUI HAL code. These are the methods you'd modify if you want to add back USB support instead of only Bluetooth support. Hid cookie BLE app is the entry point for our application. It's going to allocate the hid object, and then it's going to allocate the view. The majority of this code is from the previous project. It's going to disconnect Bluetooth, wait a little bit, migrate your storage profile, set some Bluetooth profile. Then it's going to start advertising the Bluetooth flipper every 100 milliseconds. And it's going to register a callback for when the connection disconnects or connects. It's going to feed the dolphin and then start running our app. When the user presses back from the submenu, it's going to exit the application by disconnecting Bluetooth, waiting, changing the storage path, setting the Bluetooth profile, and freeing resources. In the assets folder are the images used by the application. Most of these are from the original application, except for this cookie def and cookie pressed. In our hid.cc header file, we define the alloc, free, get few, and set connected status for that Bluetooth status. So now we're switching over to the hid.cc.c file. We define a tag for logging. Our hid.cc structure has the view, the hid application object, and a timer. We're actually not using left and right from our model, so let's remove those. So our model has the state of the key presses, up, down, and OK. Whether or not we're connected to Bluetooth, if we're in the upper left corner, and the timer's duration, and if it's enabled. In the draw callback, if we're connected to Bluetooth, we'll draw the BLE icon, otherwise we'll draw the disconnected icon. Next, we'll use the primary font to draw cookie clicker in the upper left corner. Below that, we'll write how many milliseconds we're using between clicks. The %0.1f means to show one decimal point. And if clicking's enabled, we'll write the word clicking below that. Next, we'll draw circles. If the up button's pressed, we'll draw an icon for that. Then we'll draw an arrow. And if the down button's pressed, we'll draw an icon for that. And then we draw its arrow. And if the OK button is pressed, we'll draw the cookie pressed icon. Otherwise, we'll draw the cookie def icon. And then in the bottom left, we draw the back arrow and we write the text back to menu. Hid.cc update timer is going to check the model to see if click is enabled. If it is, it's going to start the timer with the duration specified in the model. Otherwise, it's going to stop the timer. Hid.cc tick callback gets invoked every time that timer fires. It's going to check the model, and if the clicking is enabled, it's going to click the left button, wait 10 milliseconds, and then release the left button. Hid.cc reset cursors from the original code, and it just moves the mouse to the top left and then down a little bit. Hid.cc process press and process release just set the visual state so we see those buttons in the UI. Hid.cc input callback is our view's input callback. For press and release, we're calling that previous method to set our UI state. When the OK value is pressed, we toggle click enabled. So if click enabled is false, it's true, or true, it's false. Then we update the timer, which will enable or disable the timer. If the up button is pressed, we change the timer duration to 95% and update the timer. If the down button is pressed, we change the duration to 105% and update the timer. And if the back button is pressed or held, we say consumed is false, which will let the default handler handle the back button, taking us to the submenu. Hid.cc alloc is going to alloc that hid.cc structure. It's going to set the hid value to the hid value that was passed into this method. It's going to allocate a view and set that to the view property. It's going to set hid.cc for the view's context for callbacks. It's going to allocate a model for hid.cc model size. It's going to set our draw and input callbacks to be hid.cc draw callback and hid.cc input callback. And then with that view model, it's going to set the default time duration to 22 milliseconds and turn off clicking. It's then going to allocate a timer object for periodic timing, but it's not going to start that timer yet. And then it's going to return the hid.cc allocated object. Hid.cc free is just going to free those resources that we allocated. Hid.cc get view is just going to return their view object. And hid.cc connected status is going to set our Bluetooth model connected status to either true or false. Is cursor set as false, so we'll move to the upper left corner. All right, congratulations. We made it through all the code. Now let's look at the .flipcorg directory. Okay, this is an optional directory. You can see that there's a banner.png. This will show at the top of the page. And then in gallery, you put all the screenshots for your application. All right, well, I've committed all these files to my GitHub repo. So let's go ahead and kick it off in the store. I haven't built this project in the store before, so hopefully everything goes well. So we're going to go ahead and click on the build button and then put in the name of your repository. So in my case, it's jamesonderrick/flipper-0-tutorials. Once you've typed in that path, you're going to want to click on settings here to expand the settings dropdown. And then in root, we're going to type in the path to this project, which is hid_cookie. I'm currently on the Rogue Master firmware, so I'm going to choose that. I'm on the release channel. So at this point, everything is set up properly and we can go ahead and click on Let's FAP. Great, we can see that the screenshots got pulled in down below and the banner at the top also got pulled in, so that's exciting. It's building now, so while that's building, I wanted to show on my Flipper that on the SD card apps Bluetooth that we currently only have 3 applications and the cookie clicker's not installed. So we'll close the QFlipper app and now we're going to try the install button. So you can see it brings up a COM port, so I'm going to say connect. Okay, and it just installed it onto the Flipper. And now I'm going to go ahead and click on run on Flipper. Bring back up our QFlipper app. And look at that. Oh, that's so cool. So it's now running on here. Let's back out and we'll go to apps. And there it is. Nice. And then back in our QFlipper files, we can go into apps and Bluetooth, and there's the cookie BT file as well now. Awesome. You can also click the download button, and what that's going to do is just open a file onto your downloads folder so that you can have the FAP file to install locally later. I don't know how often this recently built. Oh, there it is. Cool. Recently built cookie clicker. So there you have it. And now we can have other people can easily install it. All they're going to have to do is click here. And then choose which firmware that they want and which channel they want. Oh no, it's a good thing I'm doing this video, I guess. It looks like it doesn't actually build on the official firmware. oh noes. So it looks like we have an unused parameter on line 132 that we need to fix. And I believe on 123, we also have the same problem. I pushed the new files to GitHub, so I don't know if we need to just do a refresh. Looks like a refresh is good enough. So that's the importance, I guess, of trying to build with each of the firmwares when you're making an app, just to make sure that all the settings are valid for all the apps. Great, so that worked for the official firmware. So now let's go ahead and try Unleashed. There you go. And we have unleashed as well. So it looks like it's building for all the firmwares now. And then people will be able to click on it. And then they can also, if they click on this author, it will take them back into the app and they can see the directions and release notes and stuff. So anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe. And if you have a few extra moments, if you can head over to Talking Sasquatch and Tech and Fun and check out some of their videos and subscribe to their channels too, that'd help them out. Thanks a lot. Have a great day.